I have a story to tell you. It's a good story. It's a story of a bunch of people who came across the Atlantic Ocean to carve for themselves a place in a new land, a very different world than the world they're used to. It's a story of risk-taking, of commitment-making. It's a story of a community with all of its joys and sorrows, with all of its growths and its declines. But ultimately, it's a story of faith, a faith in their God, because they knew that they were part of His church and His story. The story begins in post-World War II Europe, where rebuilding after the most destructive war the world has ever seen was a daunting task. It was particularly difficult in Holland. And the Dutch left their homeland by the tens of thousands in those post-war years. Many of them immigrated to Canada, to southwestern Ontario. They came with little to nothing, on their own, or with families in tow, and they took any work they could find. And most of them ended up on farms and slowly began building lives for themselves and their families. And it was in 1949 that a number of these Dutch families decided they would come together for worship in the countryside outside of London, Ontario. The first worship service was held in the Hagsma home close to Ilderton.
We started having a service in our home. Eventually, the neighbors got suspicious of the cars in our laneway. They contacted my dad's employer, and he in turn suggested we had a different meeting place. It turned out a small church in the village we could rent. By the time this group got bigger and bigger, it was decided to split the congregation. Half of this group would start a church in Strathroy, and the other half would look to London. Several meetings were held, and it was decided that the Talbot Street Church was a good location.
This group named itself the First Christian Reformed Church of London. In 1953, the church purchased the 70-year-old First Baptist Church on Talbot Street for $50,000. That was an incredible step of faith for those recent immigrants. Few of them owned a farm or house or any property. By today's standards, they were living in poverty. And yet, they made a commitment to establishing a church in downtown London.
In 1952, my family decided to move to Canada. So we moved to London. We had Pastor Reverend John Gritter. Well, and you know, American pastors are very strict. And Pastor Gritter always looked very stern. I was actually a little afraid of him. One day my dad said to us, okay, tomorrow night we're going to have a family visit from Reverend Gritter and an elder, and you better make sure that you're home. And here comes Gritter with an elder, Mr. Van Arnhem. So they sat down, and at first they did some small talk with my dad, probably talked about, you know, the church. And then Gritter went around the half circle, and with my sisters, I don't remember what he said to my sisters, but then he came to me, and he said, now Betty, you better not go to the movies anymore. He said, because Christians don't belong there. I thought to myself, well, how does he know that I go to the movies? I didn't say anything, I just looked at him. Then I thought, little does he know that I even go dancing at the store club occasionally. And when they left, the elder Van Arnhem turned back and winked at me.
And then, in 1959, only 5 years after they purchased this building, disaster struck.
We came in 54, and we were one of the first ones here, my family, to go to church here. So all of a sudden, the church was condemned. They made us close the doors. We couldn't be in the building anymore because they had seen something there that on the balcony that started to sag a little bit. And then they got up into the rafters in the trusses, and they noticed that some of the trusses had started to give out. Nobody really knew what to do. All the people were very upset, of course. And they hired engineers, and they came to check, and they said, yes, it can be fixed, which was a great relief to all of us, of course. And they drew up plans with tie rods that you can still see today to keep the walls close together.
Well, some had advocated for abandoning the building and moving out of downtown, This first major challenge was overcome. Not only were the tie rods attached to hold the walls together, trusses in the attic were patched, the heavy slate roof was removed, the bell tower and the turrets were taken down as well. And while the building lost some of its grandeur, the congregation kept growing.
Often people wonder how come we're still downtown, and obviously this has been an amazing journey. When I came here as a young man in my late teens, we had the beginning of this debate as to whether or not we should even stay in this place. That was a real push to move to the suburbs.
As a steady influx of Dutch immigrants continued to arrive in Canada, the church continued to grow. It was a pretty homogeneous, ethnic-centered church, establishing its toehold in the New World. In the 1960s, Christian Day School became a major emphasis. London Christian Elementary School opened its doors in 1961, and the London Christian High School opened in 1965. By 1967, First Christian Reformed Church had nearly 1,000 members, and a decision was made to birth a new congregation in the east end of the city. And so in 1968, the Bethel Christian Reformed Church was formed. The ministry of the church began to spread its wings with a campus ministry at the University of Western Ontario in 1970. The connection of the campus ministry to First CRC gave the church a new youthful dimension, and it was led by its then young John Van Til. The church was slowly growing beyond its ethnic centricity. And the church grew steadily in the 70s and the 80s. And in 1989, Good News Church was born out of both this church and Bethel. Ministries continued to grow, no longer as a result of immigration, but of childbirth.
Eventually, in the 90s and the early 2000s, the vision started to change, and the vision was recast. The vision became all about how can we be a church downtown?
Although it may look quiet on the outside, inside the First Christian Reformed Church in London, Ontario, things are cooking. Chopping, stirring, baking, mixing. It's a mishmash of food and fellowship. Deb Raukema is kitchen director.
There's 10 people in each group that take home food. We cook large quantities of food for really good prices, and it's nutritionally based.
It's called the Collective Kitchen, and every other week the church opens its doors to Raukema and her group.
So here we were having this now very progressive discussion about staying downtown and refurbishing what we had. In fact, expand the facility so we could reach out to this community downtown.
In the late 90s, when we got an engineer in and we went through the church, and at that time they said that if we didn't do something, the church would have another 5 to 10 years. So that's when we decided that something had to be done. I was kind of put in charge of the volunteer help. And I would say 75 to 80% of the people signed up for something. One of the things we said at the time was everybody should have a hard hat on and safety boots. If I remember right, I think there were maybe 3 of us that had safety boots on, and absolutely no one ever had a hard hat on. But the amount of hours that were put in by volunteers, it had saved us piles of money. And this is the finished product. I think we did pretty good.
So here we are, almost 27 years later in the Collective Kitchen, in this beautiful new facility. And I think the history that you have to know is where we started. Back in the day, I remember cooking a big pan of soup with someone, and something fell from the rafters into our pan of soup. Dust ball, I'm not sure. We just kept on stirring. We looked at each other and stirred up that soup.
truly a privilege for us to manage this project. The design, when we put this building together, the committee had a vision for the church. The glass atrium idea came up. A real interesting concept, you know, with the traditional church that doesn't look all that inviting to the atrium, which is a glass enclosure, open, friendly look. Hopefully it makes it more inviting to the community. And so that was encouraging for us to see, for me and especially, to see as a member here that the vision has really worked out in the facility.
Just the whole vision of how we can be community here in downtown London, the community opportunity scan, the opportunities that God presented for us. And then, yeah, just working with a great group of committed volunteers here in the church, part of the teams that we've developed for design and for finishing, and then the volunteers that came out during construction, doing the painting, doing the flooring, a great group of people there, and just bringing the whole congregation together in ways that we can serve best. The financial part, the commitments and the campaigns that we ran through the years, just the amount of contribution from the congregation was just wonderful to see that on top of the regular budget, people were still willing to participate.
I've been part of this community for my whole life. I was born here in London and baptized in this church, and did profession of faith in this church, grew up here. And I'm very thankful for this community and what it has done to shape me as a person. And I'm also thankful for the fact that we want to raise up another generation, and I'm thankful for the ability to be involved in raising the next generation. And I'm thankful for a space like this where we can play and we can talk and we can laugh and we can learn and we can grow together. I'm thankful that this church was willing to make space for the youth group to be, for catechism classes to be, for GEMS and cadets to be, so that we can come together and learn and grow together. And as thankful as I am about where this church has been in the past, I'm excited where this church will go in the future.
God placed us here for a reason. So a difficult journey, nevertheless, but a visionary journey at the same time. A journey that reflects the commitment of this congregation to the downtown, to be a light downtown, to build a future downtown.
It's a wonderful story, isn't it? However, the story is not yet complete. This church was founded before most of us were born, and I suspect it will be a community of believers for generations yet to be born. But for now, it's our time. It's our time to listen to God's call to tell the story. It's our turn to take the risks. It's our turn to keep the commitments. It's our turn to write the next pages of this story, his story for this church. It's up to us to continue to grow in faith, to continue to discover Christ in ways we've yet to think of. It's our particular blessing to listen, to be able to listen to the Spirit of God as he renews his world in our time and in this place.